Hirsch.
I'm Jim Carney, and this is EdCast, a program created and produced by educators for everyone interested in education.
While there are many factors which influence how children achieve in school, the quality of the teacher appears to be a major one. The goal, then, is to provide students with the best possible teachers. But do we know what makes great teachers? Do schools of education provide teachers with the expertise they need? How should teachers be evaluated? Today, Elizabeth Green, author of Building a Better Teacher, How Teaching Works and How to Teach It to Everyone, joins me to examine the practices and support that lead to classrooms where children learn best.
But is there consensus on how to teach our teachers? I'll get other perspectives later in the program. But now to Linda and her guest in the studio.
My guest today is Elizabeth Green, journalist and co-founder of Chalkbeat, a nonprofit education news organization. She joins me today to discuss her new book, Building a Better Teacher, How Teaching Works and How to Teach It to Everyone. Thank you for joining us today on EdCast.
Thanks for having me.
What prompted you to write this book?
Well, the book started with an assignment from the New York Times Magazine that had to do with this new research that was coming out about this. The research was showing that the quality of a teacher in front of the students was the most important factor in whether students learned, and yet nobody could figure out what could predict what made a good teacher. So this was kind of a conundrum that teachers matter so much, but we don't know what makes a good teacher. So I took that assignment and ran, and I ended up learning some really surprising things that changed the way I think about education, which inspired me to write the book.
You had a really nice quote early in the book that Jerome Bruner, cognitive psychologist, talked about, the vicissitudes of intention.
Yes.
Where you start out to do one thing and then something happens and you change everything.
Yes.
Did that happen to you in doing this book?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I love that quote. That's exactly what happened. I thought that I was going to be figuring out what makes a good teacher, what separates the good teachers from the bad teachers, but I ended up realizing that that whole frame that I had and that many of us had and that informs a lot of our public policies about how we do public education in this country was wrong, that it's wrong to think about people being predetermined as either a good or a bad teacher. What really matters is what the teachers do in the classroom, and what that really takes is skill, knowledge, and all of that skill and knowledge is very specialized beyond what normal adults
know. So we're gonna take a close look at that in
yeah.
just a minute.
Yeah.
You know, you did open by saying that this idea that teacher effectiveness is really so important. Do you think it trumps everything? I mean, you know, there are other people who would say that poverty and other social ills really play a big role in what students achieve. What did you think about that?
Oh, yeah. Well, the research often gets misquoted or misinterpreted as meaning that the teacher trumps everything in the world.
Okay.
But no, it's the teacher seems to be more, have a greater influence than any other factor under a school's control, direct control.
So when you did your research, tell us about what you actually did to write this article. What'd you do?
Yeah, so the beginning of the article was when I sat down in a conversation with, the beginning of the book was when I sat down in a conversation with one of the people who turned out to be a main character of the book, Deborah Ball. And I was asking her, well, what makes a good teacher? And she said, you're asking the wrong question. You have to look at teaching, not teachers. And then she gave me a math problem, and she sat down with me and she showed me, first she asked me to solve the math problem, which thank God I could, it was like a multiplication problem.
Thank God, indeed, right.
And then she said, she wrote another multiplication problem, the same one but with a different answer, the wrong answer. And she said, now how do you think that a student would have come up with this answer? And I was completely stumped, and she explained to me that this is the kind of thing that teachers have to do every single day. They have to not just know what the right answer is, but simultaneously reverse engineer students' misunderstandings, look inside their minds and figure out what they were thinking, and then figure out how to reroute them on the better course. So that was the beginning of the project.
And I also know you did some traveling as well. You went to look at schools in other countries. Where did you go?
Yeah, so I did a lot of traveling in this country, met with researchers, teachers here, and then I ended up going to Japan for quite some time, over a month.
So you saw a lot of things and you have a lot of observations. Let's see if we can break down some of them. Mm-hmm. Japan, you certainly talked about, I read your article as well about math teaching, but mm-hmm. what did you notice about teaching in Japan that you think is a takeaway for us here? And let me add, by the way, one of the big things you point out is that the work being done in Japan had its genesis and ideas that came from this country, and we should talk about that later. But what did you see in Japan?
Yeah, well, I went to Japan because I was curious about this finding that came out in the late 90s about Japanese classrooms versus American classrooms. And the finding was that we created American reforms, new ideas about how to teach students better in math. And when we looked to see were those reforms showing up in teachers' classrooms, they were showing up not in the US, but in Japan. So how could that be? Essentially, this other country had managed to do something that we ourselves hadn't managed to do with our own ideas, mm-hmm. which was scale this idea of a better teacher. And that's what I went to Japan to find. And I was really surprised by some of the things I found. I think the most important was that teaching is a public good in Japan.
Okay, and what does that mean?
So,
exactly?
Whereas in the US, teachers told me a lot about their isolation, how they rarely get chances to see other teachers teach, much less even get to think about what they're going to do before they go into the classroom. In Japan, teachers watch each other teach all the time, and they also have quite a lot of time outside of the act of teaching to think and plan and prepare for what they're going to do. So, in the US, we have 1,000 hours that the average teacher spends in class mm-hmm. with students. In Japan, it's 600 hours or less. So that's 400 extra hours each year that the teacher has to plan. And that's not to mention all the time the teacher has to look, watch other teachers teach. And this creates a completely different way to share ideas, build knowledge over time, and improve practice.
So it becomes a real reflective practice, and Japanese teachers have the time. I read a quote somewhere, I don't think it was your book, where someone in the United States said, why should we pay teachers for teacher prep? You know, they should do that at home, you know, or that's, you know, we shouldn't, you know, we pay them enough already. And I think that kind of attitude then is the opposite what you saw.
In Japan, that's the opposite. When you know, how do we define the work of teaching? Is it just in this country? I think we think of teaching as something you can just get up and do if you have the right qualities. If you're a good teacher, mm-hmm. you could just stand in front of anyone and teach them anything. In Japan, the teacher's office is actually outside of the classroom where they're teaching. It's in a place with other teachers where they're actually doing work, because that is the work of teaching. It happens before you go into the classroom and it happens after. And the thing about this country is that the teachers who are making a real difference, and there are lots of them in this country, they have to do it completely against the grain. They do have to take their own time.
And they will no matter what anyway, because there's never enough time.
But
that idea of teaching being a respected profession, I mean, I think when you mm-hmm. set that time aside, what you're really saying is that you respect the work the teachers do. If you don't set that time aside, then in some way I think the message is you don't respect the work the teachers do, but that's how it looks to me. But okay, mm-hmm. you stressed, and you said it earlier on in the beginning, that teachers really need to have a deep knowledge of their students. They have to know them in a deep way.
Yeah.
What does that mean, and how can we achieve that?
Yeah, so I was giving the example of the math mm-hmm, problem
right.
that really opened up my eyes and set me on this project. Teachers' knowledge that they bring to the subject, it's not enough to know the subject well. So that same kind of question that stumped me, I was very glad to know that those whole list of those questions has been given to professional mathematicians, and they also fail. But that's the kind of knowledge that teachers need. So in math, what it means is knowing the common mistakes that you can predict that students will make. It also means knowing how to represent an idea so that students will understand. So for example, you and I know how to divide fractions, like 1/2 divided by 3/4. We can remember the mm-hmm. procedure. We even have some idea of what that really means. Mm-hmm. But could we think of, on our own, without any training, how to represent division of fractions to students? No. So coming up with a problem, knowing common mistakes, and this applies to multiple disciplines, like teaching English, which I know was an area that you worked mm-hmm. in, you have to know not just what the canon is, but how students are likely to respond to it. Because it doesn't really matter if you're trying to teach something that students aren't going to read or engage with.
Each discipline then, in some ways, has its own way of teaching it as well. So it's knowing the students, knowing the kinds of, I'm just trying to recap, knowing some of the mistakes that they make, which I imagine experience helps you with as well. I can't imagine a new teacher really being able to know how students misrepresent things and make mistakes until you've seen a bunch of them. But that said, and then the actual content discipline, and then what are the effective ways of teaching that discipline. So that's a lot.
It's a lot, and it's different depending on the discipline, which is another thing that I was surprised to find out. You would expect that there's just one kind of generalizable teaching skill, but that's not the case.
Maybe that's the problem when we take teachers out of their discipline. I think some of the research shows that in math, for instance, a lot of teachers who teach math are teaching math out of their discipline.
Right.
That is not their discipline.
Right.
So maybe that's one of the issues. These are really good things coming out of your book. It was so provocative for me, and thought-provoking is really what I meant. It really gave me a lot to think about. So teachers have a lot they have to know. They have to know their content.
Mm-hmm.
They have to know how to deal with their students. So, and I mentioned experience, but let me ask you, what is the role of experience?
Yeah, well, excuse me. I think that the role that it plays today is that we expect teachers to learn merely through experience.
Okay.
And in fact, experience does seem to be related to teachers getting better at helping students learn, as determined by standardized tests. Mm-hmm. But I think that that's another problem, right? Should we really expect everyone to learn this really complicated craft on the job at the expense of the students who they're working with? I think that the people that I write about in this book showed me that, no, maybe we can think about this differently. Maybe we can think about it more like a profession like airline pilots, who we would never say, like, just take this plane with 30 small children on it and figure out on the job how to fly it. Please get from point A to point B. You'll figure it out as you go. Only experience can teach you how to do this.
Some of my flights have felt that way, but I'd like to think that was not the case.
So I think that there are things that we can do to help teachers be more responsibly prepared so that from day one, they know some of the basic things that they're going to encounter.
Raises some interesting points, and that is, again, this experience versus preparing you even before. Obviously, I would prefer to be with a pilot who's flown a lot, even though they all have this preliminary training where they work in a pilot institute, whatever you call it, and they learn how to fly, and they learn to anticipate disaster. But I would imagine that the pilot who's had to really get his plane or her plane out of a disaster is the one that I would want to fly with. But that doesn't change the fact that there has to be some preliminary experience.
Right.
What you mentioned, infrastructure in schools, that's what's lacking in terms of teacher education. Let's delve into that a little bit. What does that mean?
Yeah.
And what could we prepare teachers with before they tackle the job?
So after I went to Japan, I had to answer this question. What was it about Japan that allowed the country to have this culture around teaching that treats it like a craft, plus time, structures, opportunities for everyone to learn, whereas in our country, we haven't had that? And the answer is infrastructure.
Okay, and what does that mean?
So if you think about making a bridge or making any transportation system, the infrastructure are the building blocks that allow you to have roads and bridges. So in education, it's the same thing. What are the building blocks that allow you to have opportunities for teachers to learn? One of them is a common idea of what students should be learning in the first place. We don't have that in this country. So you could go to one university education school that is preparing teachers for multiple school districts in multiple states, or even the same state, where there's no agreement on even what the teachers are supposed to be doing when they get in the job.
So you mean a common curriculum in the teacher ed programs?
I mean even in the K-12 schools, and a consensus on what students should be learning in school.
Will the Common Core address that, or is it supposed to address that?
I think the Common Core is absolutely an attempt to address this. Another piece of infrastructure is the organization of work, like how the day is structured, how our teachers' time is structured. Another piece is teacher education. So all of these pieces need to be not only present, but aligned around shared ideas of what students should be learning and then what teachers need to be able to do. Without that consensus, we have incoherence. We have what one of the characters in the book calls a blizzard. And teachers, instead of having clear guidance on the kind of things they should be working on, getting better at, they have confusion. And it's no wonder that teachers feel really under assault, pulled in 10 different directions, even as they have no time to do this really, really complicated job.
Do you see as a potential problem that this idea of, I think someone called it IA's instructional activities, giving teachers what they need to teach, can lead to an overly scripted classroom? I know you'll be hearing, and you've heard, some of the objections to this notion, is that it can be overly scripted.
Right.
And even Deborah Ball is a teacher who uses a teachable moment. I mean, she, what do you say about this?
That's the fundamental challenge of preparing teachers, I think, is that great teaching cannot be scripted, and yet it's still something that we have to make sure people are responsibly prepared to do before they get to the classroom. So how do you do that? And that's actually not so different than the challenge that great teachers face in many disciplines, right? Mm-hmm. You can't script how to write a great essay. You can't script how to analyze a novel. You can't even script how to write a mathematical proof. So the idea has to be, how do we isolate the core practices that will come up again and again that teachers will have to decide how to deploy in the moment? And what I was amazed by, and I think this is the magic and inspiring, awe-inspiring power of great teaching, is that it seems impossible, but it's really not. You really can isolate within a complex practice what are the core things that need to building blocks that need to be in place. So teachers, for example, can learn routines mm-hmm. like, okay, I'm going to learn what I do in the period of my class in which students are independently working. Mm-hmm. This is a part of class that happens every day. Students are independently working, and the teacher ideally is walking around mm-hmm. monitoring. Well, what should the teacher say in those moments? This is a teachable moment for teacher educators, right? Just like every time a student writes an essay, they're going to encounter the problem of how to write the conclusion. Mm-hmm. So if you practice these things that will recur, these instructional activities or high leverage practices that every teacher needs to learn, I think you can help people to do something that's complicated.
Without telling them they have to follow a word by word script. I think that's what people either misrepresent or misunderstand, or maybe, as your book points out, some of the best ideas go awry when we put them into practice. You know, we want to teach teachers classroom control, and then it becomes a totalitarian. This is, I guess, the concern that a lot of people have. I mean, teachers, that mm-hmm. you know, you're right, I think, that there's a way of mm-hmm. giving people a foundation, but not making them feel that you can't deviate from that at all.
Yes.
And yet, sometimes it does get turned over. So let's mm-hmm. take a look at one area that you mentioned in the book, and this mm-hmm. is the idea of no excuses classrooms, mm-hmm. and the idea of a culture, and I mostly read as the culture of discipline or classroom management. Mm-hmm. What's the tension there between classroom managing mm-hmm. and teaching as you came to see it when you looked at classrooms? Or is there a tension there?
Yeah, so I think one of the amazing ironies or paradoxes about education today is that so I went to Japan, I found this case of a strong, coherent educational infrastructure that allows all teachers to be guided but still have a lot of autonomy, still have a lot of creative freedom. So I was wondering, where can I find that in this country? Is there anywhere in this country that's doing that? And there are historians that have actually studied that subject, mm-hmm. and they became convinced that there's never in all of American history been anything like the infrastructure that exists in other countries to support the craft of teaching until the rise of these no excuses charter schools that began emerging in the 1990s, and which these historians were really surprised to find have created for the first time in American history a place where teachers are treated as real craftspeople who can be supported in learning. So that's on the one hand, we have this huge opportunity in these schools. The irony is that the kind of teaching that these schools are doing has a lot of room for improvement, and that's where I got interested in their approach to discipline, because the thing within this these charter schools like KIPP, Achievement First, Uncommon Schools in this area in New York City, the thing about them that's very distinctive and that all the teachers inside of them are really wrestling with is, are we doing discipline right? Discipline is what makes us distinctive, mm-hmm. but we're in many ways uncomfortable with what we're doing.
And how does it make sure we're teaching. And, you know, I know that Dave Levin would be the first to say, and he said this, that one of the things that he had to deal with in terms of KIPP was that when his students went off to college, a lot of them were not doing well. So they did really well in the KIPP program, and I think that's then he's really candid about, and that's when he went to the Angela Duckworth, you know, the grid and the other characteristics. But I think that's another factor that what happens in our schools, do we really give them the rigor and the coping skills that they need to go beyond our very controlled environment, in this case a super controlled environment, into one that is quite the opposite. So I guess we are running out of time soon, so I want to ask you a few other things, and that's the teaching profession. Do you think teachers are getting blamed too much for everything that's happening in schools? Obviously, 50% leave within 5 years. So in spite of all those people saying it's a cushy job, this is not a job that many people want to make a life's work. Why do you think that, and what do you think we could do to attract talented people to become teachers?
Yeah, so I think that on its face, and before I wrote this book, I found this situation a little bit confusing. So on the one hand, teaching profession has gotten more dollars invested in it every year. So salaries are never going to be what we would hope, but they've been rising every single year. You have summer vacation. What's the big deal? Well, I wrote this book.
Such a good job.
Such a seems fine. And also, you know, at the same time, we're investing all of this money in not just salaries, but professional development, billions of dollars a year as a country, and yet we're not getting the results we want. So a lot of people look at that and they say it must be the fault of the teacher, especially given that teachers do play a big role in what students learn. Well, after writing this book, and the whole the reason I wrote this book is that I don't think we're thinking about this right. I think that it doesn't surprise me at all, having understood what teachers have to do every day, that teachers feel under assault, because they really are under assault, because we don't understand what teachers actually have to do. So yes, we can give them all of these professional development days in the world, and we can increase their salary, but that does not help them confront the problem they have every single day of how to help children learn.
Well, I mean, the idea of how teachers should be evaluated is, of course, become a big controversy, and the idea of linking their performance to student test scores has become the big issue in Race to the Top, starting with No Child Left Behind. What were your thoughts on that after you looked at all the evidence? And I think you really did take a look at everything in a thorough way.
I think that the two main policy ideas we have about how to improve teaching are both flawed, because both of them start from this misapprehension that there's just good teachers and bad teachers, this myth that teachers are naturally born and they don't require training. So one of those ideas is accountability. That starts with this premise of good and bad teachers, right? If there are just good and bad teachers, then what we should do is root out the bad ones, make sure we get them fired, and find the good ones and reward them and attract more good ones into the profession. But the reality is there aren't good versus bad teachers. There's good and bad teaching, and there's good and bad supports to get us to good teaching, and we have mostly bad ones. We don't have a system for helping everyone reach high teaching, and that's a very different prescription than evaluation.
And there are not a lot of teachers ready to take the place of all those bad teachers that we might let go.
Exactly.
Our time is up completely. I'm so sorry. I wanted to ask you about your own teaching experience. I know you had a day of teaching.
Well, you can read about it in the book.
Was it eye-opening for you?
Oh my gosh, it was amazing.
Can you tell us your one takeaway that you took from being in the classroom yourself?
I write about many, but the one that was most powerful for me was that I had been really skeptical of something a character in the book tells me about the power of love in teaching, but I came to really think that there's something to that idea, and that was something that I held on to in a very difficult moment, and it changed everything for me.
Thank you so much for joining us today. This was a wonderful conversation. I'm really glad that you could come by.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth Green, author of Building a Better Teacher, How Teaching Works and How to Teach It to Everyone. Thanks so much for joining us on EdCast. Welcome back to this edition of EdBytes.
The United States often looks enviously at high scores posted by South Korean students on international tests of reading and math. But evidence exists that even South Korea is looking to adjust its emphasis on high-stakes testing. Faced with high youth suicide rates and South Korean families turning to schools where students can pursue their own interests instead of studying 12 hours a day for the national exams, the government is looking at ways of reforming the educational system.
Here's a new addition to our continuing and often contradictory reporting on the merits or demerits of video games. NBC News and the BBC report on research in the UK, which found that tweens and teens who spent an hour or less each day playing video games were better adjusted and less prone to behavioral problems than their peers who did not play at all. However, those positive effects diminished when gaming time reached 3 or more hours each day.
Well, that does it for this edition of EdCast.
Until next time, class dismissed. We hope you enjoyed this episode of EdCast, and we invite you to join us for our new season. EdCast is a unique program created, written, and produced by educators, covering all aspects of education. In the months ahead, we'll examine a diverse range of topics making the news. These include an analysis of New York City test scores on the Common Core exams, the Chancellor's vision for New York City schools, the new reading wars, special education students, space issues in public schools and the impact of co-locations, the big promises of pre-K and innovative approaches to turning around struggling schools. As always, we bring you conversations with leaders in the field, the educators, researchers, and government figures responsible for transforming education. And we want to know the issues in education important to you. Join us this year for the real deal on education. No agenda, no hype. EdCast on CUNY TV.